here for the oil giant Unocal in the Afghan oil pipeline deal. In 2005, he was moved to Iraq, replacing John Negroponte as US ambassador in Baghdad. The second Afghan ambassador, Ronald Neumann, was following in his father's footsteps.
I, Ronald E. Neumann.
Literally. His father had been U.S. ambassador in Afghanistan over 30 years before.
The struggle in which we are contending is not a clash between civilizations. Rather, it is a clash within Islam that seeks to remove our influence so that it can impose by force a narrow view that would restrict human freedom and progress throughout the Islamic world. It is a view of Islam that has been repeatedly rejected by Muslim scholars, and much rests on our success in Afghanistan.
After just over a year in office, Neumann told the New York Times that the US could only avoid defeat in Afghanistan by spending multiple billions over multiple years. Last year, the United Nations Development Report revealed what 7 years of war and NATO occupation have done to Afghanistan. Only three countries in the world ranked lower on the UN Development Index. Life expectancy has fallen since 2003 to just 43 years of age. 6.6 million Afghans, over a quarter of the population, do not meet their minimum daily food requirements. 69% have no access to clean water. Infant mortality has risen since 2001 and is now one of the highest rates in the world. Neither has there been much political progress. In 2002, Ahmed Karzai brought back the old king as a ceremonial head of state, despite the king's previous favourable attitude toward Hitler and Mussolini right up to 1945. Brought back from the Italian Riviera, he was enthroned in the restored presidential palace, the very same palace that King Abdurrahman had restored after the British destroyed it in 1878. There has only been one election under the occupation in 2005, and it was organised with the aid of two United States PR firms. In that election, only a third of those eligible to vote actually did so. One indicator, however, has risen almost exponentially: opium production. It rose 1,000% in the first year of the occupation. President Karzai promised to reduce poppy production by 30% in 2005 and to eliminate it altogether by 2011. But in 2007, Afghanistan accounted for 92% of global heroin production. And now the local warlords are building heroin processing plants as well as selling the raw opium crop. And foreign occupation has, as it has always done in Afghanistan, met with fierce resistance. In 2003, the RAND Corporation estimated that a successful occupation requires one soldier for every 1,000 civilians. That would mean that the occupation of Afghanistan would need 500,000 NATO troops. There is currently less than one-fifth of that number, despite the surge of an extra 17,000 soldiers ordered by President Obama. The Taliban once more control wide swathes of Afghanistan, and many observers believe that the war is unwinnable. It is certainly unwinnable without even more widespread killing. And many of those who die will be civilians, especially as NATO has to rely on indiscriminate air attacks to compensate for lack of troops on the ground. Worse still, the war is spreading to Pakistan, where many of the resistance bases exist. The United States military now refer to this whole area of operations as AFPAC, Afghanistan and Pakistan. President Obama has ordered both air and ground attacks on Pakistani territory. So now, the world's mightiest nuclear-armed power is launching attacks on Pakistan, another nuclear-armed power. If the tragedy of Iraq is that it has been cursed by the attentions of the major powers because of what it has under its land, it is the tragedy of Afghanistan to be cursed with the attentions of the major powers because of where its land lies. For the British, it was the buffer state between the Russian Empire and India, the prize of the British Empire. For the Russians and the United States in the Cold War, it was once again a border state that was unlucky enough to be caught between two great powers. Now, once more, Afghanistan is at the wrong place at the wrong time. Two of its neighbors are rivals of the United States, Iran and China. One is an unstable ally of the United States, Pakistan. Others, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, are Soviet successor states where Russian and Western influences rival each other. In the minds of those who launched the war in Afghanistan, there are clear parallels with the past. Robert Cooper, a key advisor to Tony Blair, wrote at the time of the invasion, "The opportunities, perhaps even the need for colonization, is as great now as it ever was in the 19th century." But such easy certainties are hard to maintain in a country where few things are certain. One member of the Afghan parliament, Malaya Joya, sees things very differently. "Here there is no democracy, no security, no women's rights. When I speak in parliament, they threaten me. These men who are in power, never have they apologized for their crimes that they committed during the wars, and now, with the support of the US, they continue their crimes in a different way." But there are two lessons from Afghanistan's past. The first is that ordinary Afghans have never profited from the interference of the great powers. Indeed, the dependence on foreign funds, from the British subsidies in the 19th century to the United States aid in the 21st century, has made a small number of Afghans rich and kept most Afghans poor. The second is that Afghans have never tolerated the occupation of their country. Occupying powers have lost many lives and much money in Afghanistan, but they have never subdued its people.